Now let's talk about oil exploration. There have been several suggestions at this point for the Philippines to already pursue our oil exploration of the Reed Bank. There was a moratorium during former President Duterte's time, and there are talks that we might do it. But at one point there were talks we should do it with China. But after the incident, this water cannon incident and others, you have sectors saying the Philippines should just do it. Where do you stand on that, Senator?
Well, number one, I don't think we have the technology to do it. We need to do it with another country who has the technology to do that. Number two, Karen, this was attempted during the time, if I'm not mistaken, of former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, privately, not officially or not by government. If you remember, a corporation was formed by some big businessmen here in the Philippines and their counterparts in China to jointly explore and see if there is indeed oil in that area.
In the Reed Bank, yeah.
Without touching sovereignty issues, without saying that it's yours, it's mine, ang kasunduan nila was the Chinese corporation will get permits from their country, the Philippine corporation will get permits from our country, and they will jointly explore it for possible oil reserves. When the term of President Macapagal Arroyo ended, I think it was scrapped by former President Aquino. But yeah, that is one.
Because the argument, I'm sorry to cut you, the argument of Justice Carpio is exactly that was the problem, is the Philippine government should just contract the private company to help explore, but it shouldn't be a partnership because the Reed Bank is within the EEZ.
That is true, Karen. Foreign policy, the chief architect of foreign policy is the president. At that time, it was former President GMA. And she thought that that was a way, without giving up Philippine sovereignty and rights over this area, to explore. Dahil malay mo nga naman, kung wala namang laman yan, baka kusang loob nang umalis ang China. Dahil lahat tumataya na may lamang resources yan. Justice Carpio's position is not wrong to my mind, Karen, but it is a hardline position. Very much like what you said earlier, nagdadalangalan ng supply, binubomba, tinaharang na eh, paano pa kaya ito? So ganun din to, that is a hardline position that will face most likely tough and stiff resistance from China. We can do all we want, but the question is, how serious are we at achieving the results we desire? So hindi naman palaging hardline, sometimes you have to compromise. As long as you're not giving up or waiving any rights that we have insofar as ownership over these Philippine waters and islands are concerned.
Hey, Senator, I wanted to ask you, but isn't that the problem with the Philippines? China isn't taking us seriously. I mean, all these years, they've already reclaimed the islands within our waters, now moving closer and closer. We've technically, our fishermen have partly lost Scarborough, and they're inching their way towards really Palawan, frankly. So I don't know with our actions if we're being taken seriously at this point by China.
Well, Karen, let me throw the question back at Philippine authorities. There have been several rumors that most of the boulders, sand, and gravel that was used to reclaim Scarborough Shoal actually came from the Philippines. Para sa akin, legally, well, at least that's proof kung talagang galing dito yung mga buhangin at batong ginamit sa pag-reclaim niyan. Well, at least that's a DNA proof na atin talaga yan dahil yung lupa yung ginamit ay galing sa Pilipinas mismo. Pero ang tanong ko, ba't natin pinayagan? Ba't hindi natin inalam? Dahil tandaan mo, Karen, ang mainland China ay napakalayo para magdala ng buhangin, bato at graba para punuan at i-reclaim yan. Maraming mga balibalita na yan ay galing daw sa Pilipinas mismo. Ang magandang malaman, so but tayo hindi siseryosohin eh samantalang pinayagan nating gawin at mangyari yan habang tinututulan natin. I think we have to look at ourselves in the mirror first before and look at ourselves and consider ourselves more seriously about this topic before we can ask other countries to take us seriously. If that is indeed true, di ba malungkot yun, Karen? Ginamit yung sarili nating resources para ika nga mag-creeping invasion sa ating bansa, sa ating teritoryo.
Okay, now moving on to actually putting our money where our mouth is and looking at ourselves, you will be facing the budget soon, the 2024 budget. And I wanted to ask you where you stand. The Philippine Coast Guard has said on Head Start, their intelligence funds is only at 10 million pesos. And yet you have 10.1 billion pesos of confidential and intelligence funds in the 2024 budget, 4.5 billion with the president, the office of the VP at 500 million, DepEd still at 150, more civilian agencies asking for intelligence funds. And here you are, you have the Coast Guard at 10 million. Where do you stand on this, Senator?
Let's distinguish, Karen. Confidential funds may be lodged in civilian agencies. Intelligence funds cannot be lodged in civilian agencies. Intelligence funds only belong to military or uniformed agencies. Number two, insofar as the budget is concerned, I intend to revert back to the old provision of the budget with respect to the utilization of both confidential and intelligence funds. In the past, Karen, you need a proposal and the signature of the president before intelligence and confidential funds can be released. To a certain degree, it can be delegated, but it still requires the signature of the president. That's why it's treated uniquely. Hindi siya subject to COA, hindi siya subject sa pagbusisi ng Kongreso insofar as the specifics of how this fund, intelligence or confidential, was spent in the previous year. Kaya yung check at balance, kinakailangan hanggang sa pinakamataas na opisyal ng bansa. In fact, the law before, the budget before, even requires not only a proposal but an actual report. Merong balik dapat, may sukle, may ROI dapat yung ginastos na pera. Ano yung resulta ng intelligence gathering? Hindi namin kailangan makita, hindi kailangan makita ng publiko, pero dapat may ganong report. That was
So
discarded
that's a
in the
form of
past.
auditing. That's a form of auditing already, at
Yun na
least.
yun, pero hindi titingnan ng COA yung laman ng dokumento, pero dapat may dokumento. As a cursory reading would suffice na, okay, may report, dito ginastos. I think we should revert to that. Insofar as the Philippine Coast Guard's intelligence funds are concerned, the president can actually augment it after the budget is passed. But Karen, I will look into the fact that if you can augment it, not from capital outlay, personnel, or maintenance and other operating expenses, but from the intelligence budget and/or confidential budget already proposed by the DBM. Para within the same amounts na lang ang pag-usapan natin. Huwag tayo magbawas ng tulay, magbawas ng school building, magbawas ng ospital, magbawas ng social services para dagdagan yung intelligence fund ng Coast Guard. Dapat manggaling din yan sa kabuuang intelligence at confidential funds na pinapropose ng executive branch.
Okay, but do you now feel then that these confidential funds, as you said, confidential funds can get into civilian agencies? Do you feel that it's become more of a political accommodation in nature? For example, I saw a record wherein former Vice President Lenny Robredo didn't have confidential funds. Binay actually started with 5 million, increased a little to 10, 20, and then by the end of his term as VP, literally was already zero. And now you have the vice president's office, which is, this is not personal against Vice President Duterte, but you have the office now at half a billion. Why do we need these?
Well, I would like to see the arguments as well, Karen, what this is for. When it was first proposed, they said that it was for national security purposes because drugs, because recruitments, insofar as the new People's Army, the CBP-NPS, was concerned, was being done. But after a year, I would like to compare. If you look at the data of the Armed Forces of the Philippines, Karen, the numbers of the CBP-NPA have been dwindling. So why the need to increase this in order to protect our students from supposed recruitment?
Yeah, that's the 150M. Go on.
Yes, at that time. Next, if you're going to increase it, so what else is it for? If you're talking drugs, I would like to know what are we protecting our students from? And remember, Karen, this is DepEd, huh? This is not CHED. You're talking grade 1 to grade 12. Ang alam ko, ang pagpasok ng recruitment, kung meron man, ay nasa higher educational institutions o sa college. hindi naman sa elementary at high school. Kahit yung droga, nasa college din yun marahil at hindi sa elementary at grade school. So I would like to see the effectiveness of the utilization of the initial 150 and why we're increasing it to 500. Although they're not duty bound to say how and where they'll spend it because that'll be the next year, they should at least justify it to Congress when they present their budget for it. And I intend to ask those questions.
Okay, Senator, the last question on this particular area. How should we empower the Philippine Coast Guard, the Navy, the Armed Forces, but more on the Coast Guard, since clearly it's our territorial waters that's in question each and every time?
Well, the reason, Karen, why we're utilizing the Coast Guard more, very much like China, is because it's a civilian agency. Yeah. The last thing you want is to increase military presence in that area, thereby stoking war rumors and mongers to ignite the fire, so to speak, in this area. And that's the last thing we want. I believe that's the last thing China would want too. There's only one way, Karen, allocate more funds for the Philippine Coast Guard if you will be utilizing them as our instruments of sovereignty, asserting our sovereignty in that area. Ika nga, put your money where your mouth is. But let me add one last thing, Karen. I commend Secretary Manalo for his statement earlier and during the budget deliberations. In fact, I already said that I prefer that it's the president and or the foreign affairs secretary who is speaking with respect to government's policy, attitude, and what they will do in this area. Instead of letting every other executive official express his or her own opinion about this matter, it's charged as it is. And the last thing we want is to add fuel to the seeming burning anger, not only of Filipinos, I presume, the national fervor of China too, with respect to this issue. Remember, Karen, our government has its own domestic audience, us, to cater to. China, too, has its own domestic audience to cater to. And it's the ideal equilibrium or balance between our relation with them and their relation and our relation with our respective populations that is making it more difficult to handle and or do or not do certain things.
Okay. Now, my last question, is it confirmed that you will really propose the 100 million pesos for a Ayungin Shoal? Because frankly speaking, with a budget more than 5 trillion, 100 million is quite doable. Or would you still want the president or Malacanang to ask for that, or you'd put it in the budget anyway?
I'll put it in the budget, Karen, as an appropriation or budget cover. In fact, Senator Jinggoy said it might not be enough. I said I would have been happy with that, but if you want to increase it, you have my blessing. Senate President Zubiri also expressed support yesterday that he will also help out in carving out from the budget. This is not on top of the budget, Karen. We'll just carve from the budget, the existing proposed budget, an amount to do this.
Senator Escudero, this is up your alley. With the debt of the Philippines now at 14.10 trillion, that's as of May 2023. By next year, we're hitting 15 trillion. The same question asked in the Senate. Should we have something to worry about? Is this worrisome?
Para sa akin, hindi, Karen. Una sa lahat, huwag tayo matakot sa utang. Lahat ng malalaking negosyante sa ating bansa, lahat ng bilyonaryo sa buong mundo, may utang at lumaki sila dahil may utang. Ang hamon sa atin, bantayan at tiyakin na yung perang inuutang natin, napupunta sa dapat talagang paglagyan. Infrastructure man, tama si Secretary Jok, no, social services. Ang magsasabi ang iba, wala namang balik sa social services. Meron. Investment ang infrastructure para sa ekonomiya ng ating bansa. Investment ang social services sa ating human capital. Ika nga, malusog, matatag, matalino at may skills na mamamayan. Yan ay napakalaking investment para sa ating bansa. Now, if indeed debt to GDP ratio has exceeded 60%, that is a point of concern. Pero Karen, let's look at it.
60% down now for the record. Go on.
Let's look at it this way. Hindi lang naman pagpapababa ng debt ang solusyon para yung ratio yan ay gumanda. Meron din yung kabila. Pagpapalaki at pagpapalago ng ating ekonomiya. Pag lumaki yung ating ekonomiya, edo yung debt to GDP ratio bababa. Pag nagbayad tayo ng utang, ang debt to GDP ratio bababa din. Pero sa kasaysayan ng mundo, Karen, mula nung inimbento ang utang, wala pa yatang bansa na zero debt. Wala pa yatang bansa na nakabayad sa lahat ng utang nila. pinakamagandang ehemplo ay ang Estados Unidos. Pinakamakapangyarihan at ika nga, pangalawa o pinakamayamang bansa sa mundo, napakalaki ng utang nila. In fact, dinowngrade sila samantalang tayo ay in-upgrade. So hindi rason yon para ikabahala natin. Hindi pa rason para ikabahala natin, lalo na Karen, as a percentage of total budget, bumababa ang ating binabayaran. At tama din si Treasurer De Leon. Ito'y ginawang shift ng bansa about a decade ago. Nakaramihan ng debt natin ay peso denominated. Bakit ito importante? Kumikita ang gobyerno ng buwis sa pamamagitan ng piso. Kung dolyar ang utang natin, dolyar din ang ibabayad natin. At pag nag-devalue ang peso, mas malaking peso ang kailangan natin para magbayad sa dolyar. The shift was made by the National Treasury, BSP, and the Department of Finance about 10 years ago na mas domestic tayo umuutang at hindi sa labas. Dahil ang kita natin, nasa piso at wala naman sa dolyar.
Okay, so part of the ability to pay debt would be revenue collection, tax collection. Let's talk about luxury taxes. This was contentious at one point, no less than President Marcos Jr. in February backed luxury taxes, but now the Department of Finance said it's off the table. Secretary Diokno said, parang the yield won't be high enough, I'm quoting, and admin costs might be high. And he cited the example of a diamond. A luxury ngayon, pero ang hindi pang itago. So let's move on from that argument. Joey Salceda also said at one point, kung itatax mo Louis Vuitton, magbibili na lang sa ibang bansa. So I want to hear your thoughts on luxury taxes.
Well, let's begin with a few points, Karen. Number one, I hope they will get their acts together. The president is saying one thing, his own Secretary of Finance and Alter Ego is saying another thing a few months after. Number two, I'm against any new taxes because I want to focus on collection efficiency. But if we will impose taxes, then why not look at the luxury tax instead of increasing road users' tax, instead of taxing internet purchases, instead of increasing the value-added tax? Why is that? Ang ginamit na ehemplo ni Secretary Diokno ay diamond. Bakit diamond lang ba ang luxury, Karen? Ang helicopter, hindi ba luxury? Ang aeroplano, hindi ba luxury? Kaya ba nilang ibulsa at itago yun? O bagong kotse? O mamahaling kotse? Hindi naman kaya ibulsa at itago yun. Pangalawa, ayon sa Constitution, taxes should be equitable, uniform, and progressive. Walang sinabi sa Constitution na pag mahirap kolektahin, hindi mo na pwedeng ipataw at wag mo nang ipataw. Now, a luxury tax is progressive. A luxury tax is equitable. And if uniformly applied to all those buying luxury items at a certain amount, then it complies with that too. Kung sinasabi ni Secretary Diokno ay mahirap kolektahin yan, well, I will use his own words. According to him, the collection efficiency of VAT is only 40%. We cannot collect 60% of the VAT we are supposed to collect. Eh, di tanggalin na rin niya yung VAT. Mahirap palang kolektahin eh, tulad ng luxury tax. Eh, bakit nandiyan ba yung VAT? Which applies to all, uniformly and equally rich or poor, but certainly not progressively. Dahil yung binabayarang VAT ng mahirap, yun din ang binabayarang VAT ng mayaman. So for me, I don't think he should dismiss it immediately. In fact, NEDA Secretary Balisakan raised some reservations about it now. Wait. We can actually look into it. So again, I go back to my first statement. I hope they will get their acts together and come up with a common stand and or position. I would rather look at this rather than increasing the road users' tax because our motorists, Karen, are paying higher taxes by way of increased fuel prices. And VAT is a percentage tax that goes up together with the price of fuel. Our motorists are paying toll simply because government has not been constructing the roads we need and listed the private sector to charge a toll. Tapos dadagdagan pa natin yung road users tax. Abay, teka muna. Patingin na muna yung mahigit 100 billion na nakolekta sa road users tax na earmarked dapat sa mga lansangan, kalye, at ayusin ang daanan, daluyan ng mga may-ari ng sasakyan, pampubliko man o pribado.
And you have a point because road users tax affects all road users, even the poor, especially the poor.
Especially the poor, because even public utility vehicles are supposed to pay that, Karen. So, syempre, pass on ng pass on yan. Pero yung rate na binabayaran sa kada sasakyan, ganun din naman, mayaman o mahirap. So it's not progressive. It may be equitable, it may be uniform, but it's not progressive. And as I said, difficulty in collection should not be a basis not to impose a tax, especially if it is a progressive tax.
Okay, so I have three questions left for you. We have just a few minutes to go, so you can just chance by this quickly. Before the end of the year, I know that the Senate President said he'd like to pass 20 priority legislative measures, but I'll ask you on one thing, because you made a stand on this. You asked, why should we replace the current National Service Training Program with ROTC? Because there's a Senate bill right now mandating all students enroll in ROTC. The Senate President said when it hits the floor, he will probably support it. You know, the Vice President, Sara Duterte, has been fighting for ROTC to come back. What about you, Senator Cheese?
I will most likely vote against it, Karen. I took a position against it. I was chairman of the committee that's supposed to tackle this. I inhibited myself. I didn't stifle it. I passed it on to a subcommittee headed by Senator Bato and told him, you want this, you defend it, I won't archive it, I won't stifle it, because I have zero backlog in my committees, and I want all bills to be tackled, to be fair. And I told him I will interpolate and most likely vote against it. And that's what I'm doing now, Karen. I'm against it simply because I don't see the wisdom behind it. That ROTC will inculcate patriotism, nationalism, and love for country. I went through CMT, Citizens Military Training, and I don't think I got love for country from that. Pangalawa, Karen, ROTC is part of NSDP. So my question is, they're brandishing a survey that says 75% of Filipinos aged 18 to 24 favor mandatory ROTC. My question is, that's a survey using random sampling. I'm using actual hard facts and data, which is, of those required to take NSDP, only 18, or on a good year for ROTC, 20% take the ROTC option. Kung talagang 75% ang may gusto niyan, hindi sana 75% ng 18 to 24 ng mga college students natin, ROTC ang kinuha. At pwede naman nilang kunin sa ilalim ng NSDP law. Now, if NSDP is not a success, my question is, where is the study that says it's not? And if NSDP is not a success and ROTC is part of NSDP, then I guess ROTC should be deemed a failure as well, and we should be looking at something totally new. Next, Karen, would be they want to include law enforcement. They want to include disaster resiliency. They want to include community service, nationalism, and patriotism. I asked for a curriculum, a program of instruction. How will this be divided? Yung number of units na lang, Karen, hindi na kami magkasundo eh. Sabi nila, 4 hours a week daw, pero 3 units. Sabi ko, basic yun, di ba? Kung ilang oras sa isang linggo, yun ang bilang ng unit. And you're including this in the curriculum because a student cannot graduate unless he completes this. So if it's going to be 2 years, so you're talking 12 additional units in the curriculum of any 2 to 4 year, 5 year course that a college student would have to pass and accomplish.
Okay. All right. Well, we don't have enough time, so I'll skip the other one, but I'll close with this. You have netizens saying there's a new Cheese Escudero. light na to. I can't resist. So you're out in Fashion Week more, surprisingly, right? There are more photos of you everywhere. And you have netizens also commenting you look different. So ang tanong ngayon, as being a senator and frankly, you being in the news all my life, is what's happening, Senator?
I'm not part of Fashion Week, Karen. Ako lang yung alalay sa likod ng asawa ko pag tuwing may Fashion Week at libre at bakante ako. Ako yung tiga-laba, tiga-luto, tiga-linis, tiga-tahe pag may kailangan tahiin. Minsan lang umaura-aura, pero hindi palagi yun. Nakukumbinsi lang at nabipilit. Insofar as the others are concerned, well, Karen, like you, tumatanda tayo. And our objective should be longevity, not really to look good or be good, but more be healthy and to preserve and have longevity. Longevity should be the objective, Karen.
Okay. Well, all right. It's nice to talk. Thank you so much for joining me today. As always, insights and humor at the end. Senator Cheese Escudero, always a pleasure. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Likewise. Thank you, Karen. Good morning to our televiewers.